This is Ham Radio Now, coming to you not live from the Orlando HamCation. I'm Gary Pierce. And before we get into this, I'll just do the quick mention about Arvin and Ham Radio Now being brought to you by you, hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy the program, get something out of it. And if you're going to get something out of this one, you probably live in the Southeast, but maybe our issues that we'll talk about here are going to be a little broader than that. I am talking to... Who am I talking to?
My name is Jim Schilling. I'm KG4JSZ.
And we're talking about here is something that has recently happened that drew a CQ editorial about the director election for the ARRL Southeastern Division. And I'm not sure that I'm competent to talk about all the details of what happened even. So tell me what happened.
At late last year, there was a announcement on the ARRL website that Greg Sarratt had been declared elected, and
as the director for the Southeastern Division.
Yes, correct. And
Greg's been working his way up through the chain.
He was previously our director, and he was unseated by the incumbent. So. In a vote, and you know,
For a whole term?
Yeah, for a whole term. And,
okay.
And I've known Greg. I remember Greg when he was coming his way up, and I believe we're friendly and stuff. And when I first got involved with what I'm doing, I did send him an email. Don't take it personal. I'm just doing what I think's right. And I thought it was kind of funny because, you know, I know there's been balloting issues on occasion. You know, I talked to somebody the other day and I said, well, they claimed at one time they didn't get their ballot, and I said, well, tell me an ARRL election where somebody doesn't claim they didn't get their ballot. So I saw that, and I thought it was very strange. And
I think we skipped a step.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Greg was declared elected.
Declared elected.
But he had competition.
He did. He had the incumbent. And I'll jump a little ahead, because what I later found out was that the incumbent, within days of the ballots allegedly being sent out, was declared no longer valid. So that's why he was declared elected, because...
And who are we talking about?
That would be Doug Rehman. I saw this thing and I thought it was very strange, and I was like, my assumption was, hey, I didn't get my ballot. So I called the league. What do you do? Hey, oh, there must have been a mistake, and let's get something corrected, because I'm a life member, so... And I've been at the same address for going on 14 years, so... nobody knew what to do. I got passed around a whole bunch. Somebody was supposed to call me back and make it real quick. While I was waiting for that person to call me back, I did a little research, found the June article that said, you know, and I looked and I said, well, according to the timeline, we should still be balloting. There's something very strange here. Wound up calling that person back because they didn't call me back, because I assumed they were busy. And they said they weren't the right person. They sent me to Sean Kutso, their PR guy, very nice guy. I like Sean. And he said, well, there was an ethics thing, and it's in the article. And I said, really? Where's that at? And he says, it's on the website. And I said, well, I can't find it. He goes, I'll send you a link. So he sends me a link to the very article that prompted my call in the first place. And I said, Sean, this is the same thing I called about. I said, but, you know, there's no ethics thing or anything on this. And that's all I can tell you.
There were no details.
There was no details. So,
And so, as I understand it, at least as I'm putting it together, you didn't get a ballot because at that point, Greg Sarratt would be running unopposed.
Unopposed.
There'll be no election.
Exactly.
Just declared elected at the end of the balloting, at the end of the period where someone could have become a candidate.
That is great. Which is the case with our vice director. We've got Joey now as our vice director because he ran unopposed. And,
yeah.
And that would be the appropriate thing.
A lot of section manager elections are unopposed, and they're just declared elected.
And it makes total sense.
Because why go through the expense of a ballot with one name on it?
Exactly.
Write-ins are not permissible.
Oh, yeah, exactly. And that's totally appropriate. But the issue kind of comes up, and you'd be better off talking with Doug about the specifics. He has a website that explains it, and I've gotten a lot of information from that, and it is one-sided, and the problem is, and the issue I have is it's twofold. One, it seems like 5 or 6 years ago they had this with a gentleman in California where the ethics committee disqualified him for issues. And they wrote a QST article, and they explained it to the membership as to why we did this action and everything else. And at the time I read that, I thought it was kind of grayish, but all right, you know, if that's what y'all feels right, at least you've explained it and everything. In this case, there's been absolutely nothing, no explanation whatsoever, and I think the membership should have an explanation, a formal explanation. The other issue that I have here, too, is the Ethics Committee, which is made up of other directors. So you have directors making judgments on directors, which don't seem... I'm not going to say it's unethical, but it just doesn't seem... It should be outside
group. It's the fox watching the hen house.
Exactly. And
this is not a personnel issue, because these are elected people, not hired people.
This is correct. So, but I believe ethics, you know, especially right and wrong, should not be done in a closet. I think, you know, if you make a ruling at ethics, as they've done in the past, you should be willing to communicate that. And they failed to do that. They just point you to the QST article or the website. This is and now, you know, there's been, I guess, threats of litigation. And, of course, everybody clams up then. But I don't think, personally, myself,
well,
I would not be...
The defense side clams up.
The other side gets loud sometimes. Yeah. Personally, myself, I wouldn't be here today. So there was a number of us that got together in Melbourne. We didn't like the way this had happened. And we talked and... you know, it wound up around December or so. Some of us were getting together again via email and talking. And there was a subject of a recall petition, because based in the ARRL bylaws, this is our only recourse as members. And the thought was it would give us at least an up or down vote on our representation. Well, at least we would have some kind of vote. And
so where we are in the conversation right now is the unspecified ethics charge was the reason for removing Doug from the ballot.
That is correct.
And that's a big black mystery spot.
Well,
we don't really know why.
Well, Doug says why, and he explains it in his website, and I would encourage people to go see that.
How to find that?
Well, if you... The easiest way I can remember off the top of my head is if you go to QRZ, I had posted an article in there initially about the petition gathering. It may be, if you go to the news tab, it may be three or four back now, because there's some, you know, eventually stories get pushed in the back. I have some links there to our website, and there's some links to the CQ editorial, and I believe we have links in there as well to, if for example, someone wanted to sign a petition, they could download it and sign it and send it to me. But I believe we also have links in there as well to Doug's timeline of events, as he puts it.
Yeah. I went across that real quickly. The gist I got from it was that Doug wanted to see the board be more transparent about what they're doing.
And
have more, maybe not membership involvement, but at least more potential membership awareness.
And I think that was a noble cause. I mean, I didn't necessarily agree with a lot of his things and maybe some of the ways he approached it, but I thought that was kind of a noble cause. And Doug wasn't alone on the board in thinking that way. And, you know, it's kind of funny, because some of the things that Doug alluded to in his message, I guess, that got him in trouble, you know, kind of be like prophecy and fulfilled itself, obviously. I would encourage people to go look at it and get informed. I mean, I try to tell the story. I couldn't possibly cover every angle. It does raise a lot of questions. But, like I said, my goal was more to give one, make awareness of this issue, because there's a lot of hams that... I was amazed this weekend that weren't aware. Well, I thought I heard something about it.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons I appreciate this opportunity, too, to get the word out a little more.
I'll look into more of it, taking advantage of the opportunity of being down here at Orlando to just talk to you, because we're here. And face-to-face is a lot easier than Skype. Although Skype works, and I'll contact Sean. I was over at the ARRL booth, and I talked to some guys over there. And the basic thing was talk to Sean.
Poor Sean's earning his money.
Because there's the potential of a lawsuit. They've been advised not to disclose very much, because whatever you say can be used against you.
This is true. I'm not sure how that's worked. I know there's a number of allegations Doug's had made, and one of my suggestions to him was, Well, if they're in they're a Connecticut corporation and in a violation of state law, have you considered, you know, because he was looking to get money at one point. I said, well, why not just ask the Attorney General to look into it to see if there's some validity to it? I mean, not that I think, I don't believe in attacking the ARRL. I don't agree with everything they do, but I support them.
There's a little subset in ham radio that has their view of the ARRL. It parallels what we're seeing with the current presidential administration.
You know, there just seem to be some similarities.
It's on a much more smaller scale, but kind of the same vector.
It is. Like I said, I had a protester, very nice lady, and we had an interesting dialogue for half an hour. She did show up. That was on Friday, and she did show up on Saturday with a little sign and everything. I offered her to stay and give the opposing opinion. She didn't seem to be that committed after all. because I even offered her a chair. I said, you don't even have to come back here in the booth. You could stay out there in front. I said, as long as you're not disruptive, there's no problem. She claimed to have known Greg for years, and she supports Greg. And I said, well, that's a good thing. I mean,
yeah, and I've known Greg for a long time. Greg was on. He's been on ham radio now, I think, but he was at least on my very first DVD documentary on Digital Voice. He was big in D-Star in the early days, and I traveled to Huntsville, and he showed me the repeater and stuff like that. And he's a great guy.
Yeah,
and I don't know that he's got any particular involvement in how this all came about, other than he was the other guy running.
I suspect not, and in a way. Like I said, I wrestled with this for a while because, one of the things about this is it's really not about him per se. My thing is that the protester, I told her, I said, if you honestly believed that Doug would have had the votes and everything and he has the support, I mean, this would be one way of legitimizing him. Because if you have a recall vote and he survives it, then he's legitimate and, I think that's a good thing. The sad side of it is, and I'm not sure how we're going right now. Things are still early. There's people gathering all over. People are downloading the petition. They're going to their club meetings and gathering these things. They'll start trickling in here as we get closer to the end date.
Is there a timetable?
Yeah, actually, the last of the ballots have to be in to headquarters by March 22nd. That is the date in the original letter that I got back from Mr. Gallagher back when I started this thing.
Yeah. So this is an ARRL procedure. You say I'd like to do a recall.
I have to send them a certified letter explaining that I want to do it. And
they initiate the recall.
Well, they in their case, they acknowledge the letter. But once I send them that certified letter, I could start gathering it. We've had a few hiccups and restarts because lack of direction from them. I've actually had an ethics committee rule that one of my statements was, I referred to Greg as appointed, and they said that's not correct. He was deemed elected. He was declared
elected. Yeah.
And I thought that was funny that it came at that stage of the game because the original letter, that same verbiage was there in the first two petitions, and obviously, if something was
It felt like a foot drag.
Yeah, it was kind of a foot drag, and it comes here halfway through. And the thing is, if it was incorrect, it should have been communicated at the onset and not down the road.
So it might have been someone just didn't catch it, or it might have been, how can we add another delaying tactic and run out the clock?
That could be. But what I have told to a number of people that have said, I've signed it in the past, I've said, listen, according to the rules as I see it, there's nothing that says you can't sign it again. If in doubt, sign it. I've started numbering the upper right-hand corner of them. Currently, we're at number 3. So 3 is the current one.
Petitions.
Three signed? Different versions.
Oh, three versions. Okay.
There's 3 versions.
Not 3 people have signed so far.
No.
How many do you need to get?
Based on information that we got from the incumbent as he came out, I believe the number of members in the division at the time that the election was occur was a little over 15,000. So something like 15,370 something was the actual number. And of course, we got to get 10% of that.
So about 1,500.
1,500 at a minimum. Yeah. I'm obviously hoping to get a few more than that because,
And I'm sorry, what was your deadline?
March 22nd.
Okay, so it's February 12th right now. So yeah, we got about 6 weeks.
Yeah, we got about 6 weeks. Like I said, you know, we're asking people to try to get them mailed in early in March. You know, hang on to them and obviously gather as much. I've even told people if in doubt, you know, even if it's just you, download it, sign it, mail it in. I'd have no problem if it's just sheets of paper. I mean, unfortunately, I have a hard copy, but I don't think a scanned copy would work. So I'm trying to stay, try to address any possible issues. So. Yeah.
I'm not sure how much the ARRL fights the idea of a recall. They've got the procedure available.
Yeah, there wasn't a lot of information and guidance in the beginning. Now, with the last letter, there was, well, if you want us to review what you put, then, you know, that, well, I only had to change that one line. They'd already seen everything else. I wasn't adding anything additional, so I think they'd seen it, so there shouldn't be any issues. So
it's really on you to come up with the right language. They'll look at it, and then you start gathering signatures and send it in.
This is true. And hopefully, at least now...
Is this your drive, or are you just helping somebody?
Well, actually, I sent the initial letter. I actually have a co-chair. Her name's Sherry Bauer. She used to be a South Florida section manager.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Sherry.
Yeah, Sherry, you know, she's been around a while. She couldn't attend. I think something came up, but she's done a lot of emails and worked some contacts and stuff. She put our website together. She took the website and I took the Facebook page. And I've helped a little bit with the, helped streamline some of the website stuff because I guess I stumbled in and figured out how to do a couple of things.
So boil down your complaint. It is that you just don't like the idea that you weren't told what really happened?
I have an issue with that. That it wasn't communicated to the members. That's primarily it. What happened? I think that should have been communicated. I think at a minimum. I mean, personally, I was a little upset that I have been an above board giving member to the ARRL. I've been a life member and I still give some money above and beyond. I sent emails to both Mr. Roderick and Mr. Gallagher and absolutely didn't even get an acknowledgement to those emails, you know, when I was asking the question what actually happened here. So I have an issue that they failed to communicate to the membership why this has occurred. I kind of have an issue as well that the ethics, I mean, from ethics thing, you know, if I had an investigation, if there's an ethics investigation and it's found to be unfounded, I don't think you need to disclose that. But if you make a ruling or a judgment about an ethics issue, I think that should be above and out in the open, and people should be aware of that. I don't think you should keep ethics in the closet. I've talked to ethics officers that I know at my company and other places, and they look at this with skepticism. So I actually think, too, that the ARRL needs to look at how they handle ethics. I think it should be an outside group that looks and reviews ethics stuff. People that aren't tied to the day-to-day activities that don't have an elected appointed position. Like I said, maybe senior elders or something who've been involved and are outside it now. I've talked with my previous director, Frank Butler, about it. I said, you might be a good candidate for that. Dave Sumner might have been another good candidate, you know, be a guy on an ethics committee that looks, who's outside it now, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
Kay Craigie.
Kay would be another one. I mean, you know, previous presidents, Joel, you know, there's presidents who might,
yeah,
be.
So people obviously no axe to grind.
No axe to grind. They're out of it
now. But
also
no dog in the hunt.
No dog in the hunt. And, you know, there's outside groups you can, you know, companies you can hire to do your ethics, but they might not understand the nuances of amateur radio where, like I said, elders, senior elders are even people highly involved outside the ARRL organization might be a good look at, you know.
Anything else besides just not really understanding why Doug was removed from the ballot?
Well, I guess
is there also an issue of what Doug was running on as a platform versus Greg? Usually there's not a whole lot of difference. It's more of a popularity contest.
It's usually a popularity. There seems to be from my eyes, Greg's kind of a go-along, get-along kind of guy, where Doug was kind of, we need to make changes and stuff. You know, I think Doug has kind of the right view long term. I think it addresses a lot of issues that the ARRL's had for years. One of the things is that if you look at the number of licensed amateurs we have, and look at how many are ARRL members. And you would think it'd be a higher number. I mean, you look at other organizations like gun owners. You know, there's a lot of NRA members.
Yeah.
You don't have that with ham radio, and the question is why. And I've heard a lot of stories. I've heard a lot of people, you know, with issues and stuff. And maybe, you know, changing the way they operate might get more people interested. I know a lot of young people, you know, it's hard to get young people into the hobby. But, you know, if you got a bunch of guys that are, let's say, behind a closed door that's making decisions, and they don't feel like, you know, and people feel like they're not being involved or informed, well, why would I want to be interested in that? So I don't think it's good for ham radio to continue the way they have. I think they've had a number of issues in the last few years where they've alienated members. And I know that you can't make everybody happy all the time. But they seem to, if you look at the number of licensed amateurs versus the number of members, they've definitely slid to one side.
Yeah, I have felt, and I've been a life member since 1974. There's no question, and I was involved back in the days of the repeater wars, and I was on a repeater guy, and thinking the league was just a bunch of fuddy-duddy old DXers and contesters and HF people and CW operators, and they thought we were CBers. And I've talked to, you know, directors like Steve Mendelson and folks after, and Kay Craigie, when I did an interview with her, and she said, oh yeah, you're kind of right, that's the way it was. I don't think it's that way anymore. Although I do think that if there's a group in ham radio that has the most influence on the way the league does things, it's probably the folks that have the most money, and those would be the DXers and contesters.
It tends to be, you know, and here's the other thing too, and I've learned this from some of the stuff I still work. You know, and I've learned that a lot of companies are trying to embrace diversity and stuff and get, you know, things. You know, and this relates more to the younger hams. I mean, you know, one of the things these people say a lot of times is, you know, when I look at the leadership, I don't see anybody there that, well, either looks like me or, in the case of ham radio, or even near my age. So, you know, if you try, I always kind of laugh in a way. You know, we've definitely tried to figure out how to get the young people involved, but the people that are trying to figure it out aren't young people.
Yeah.
How do you know? It's very, you know, we have generational issues. It's hard to communicate across generations.
Yeah. Now, of course, the ARRL board and leadership probably very much reflects the ham radio community.
I would definitely say.
So it's not like looking at the current administration's cabinet and, you know, seeing all old white men, almost.
This is true.
And saying that doesn't reflect the diversity of the country. The league actually represents the lack of diversity within ham radio. So they would have to actually force the issue to bring in more diversity somehow. And if the directors are elected positions, how are you going to do that?
Well, this is true. But, I mean, don't take me the wrong way. I love the staff up in HQ. I've visited them. I have a number of them I consider very good friends. But even the staff kind of reflects the lack of.
Yeah, they could go a little farther, or maybe a lot farther. So you're considering yourself to be the loyal opposition in a situation like this. You don't want to tear down the house.
Oh, certainly not. I would be more of a voice of change, and you know, I like I said, I support them. None of us agree with anybody 100%, but I think they do a lot of good work. And that's why, you know, once I became a life member, you know, and I do well in my career, you know, and I do donate to various charities. I've had no problem in the past supporting the league because I think they do a lot of good things. And I think the voice they provide to amateurs within legislation and everything is a very important thing. I do sometimes have concerns that I don't think they listen to their membership. One of the statements I heard this weekend, and I don't know how valid this is, but I got it from somebody, that I was told, for example, that Mr. Gallagher was sent down here by the board of directors to understand why the hams in this community were upset. I'm like, you couldn't figure that out on your own? You're possibly that detached? I thought that was kind of a funny statement. I mean, it's out there on the internet. I mean, you could go to QRZ. It's there.
QRZ. I mean, I love QRZ, but it's not my go-to place for...
No, it's not. But it was an easy place for me to get my info out at the time.
Yeah.
But, you know, there was some discussion in there, and I think it did did a recent legislation on homeowners association. It digress a few times. I went in there and I looked a few times. I'm like, I hate to say it, but I don't have that problem, but I do understand the issue. So I didn't find that interesting. So I just skipped through a bunch of it. But you know, I it's kind of in a weird, funny way. I see some of these guys show up at conventions and stuff, and I always feel bad for some of them because a lot of times amateurs just come up and complain. And I've had a policy years ago. I don't just come up and complain. I will come up and complain, but I will propose a solution, a path.
Well, a friend of mine says, Jeff, AC4ZO, you've seen him here on the show, complaining goes directly to the pleasure center of the brain.
It does. It's a, you know, my thing is, if you don't have a better solution, then, you know, you should just accept it, you know. And I've seen some of these guys just listen, and, you know, they just shut down. They're like, they're very polite, yes sir, no sir.
They don't
sir.
Want a discussion.
They just listen to the people vent. And I sometimes think they tune out. Like I said, I have some friends up at headquarters, and I talked to one of them at one time over dinner and stuff, and I said, it's amazing. I know I've come to you sometimes, and you just right away shut down because you just assume I'm like everybody else. I'm like, sometimes, I mean, you know, I can understand doing that, but once in a while you do have to surface up and listen, see, because you might miss something. You might miss a good idea.
All right. So we got till March 22.
March 22nd.
To take a position one way or the other on the petition to recall Greg Sarratt. W4OZK, I think, is Greg's call.
I believe that's correct. Yep.
And I'm not taking an editorial position on it, but I think I can agree that it would be good to have a little bit more transparency out of the league. I mean, my issue is that every time I ask someone at the top end of the league to come on the show, it's, we're busy, call us again later. And early on with Ham Radio Now, it was relatively easy to get people on and with long conversations, and it's become more difficult. My last contact back and forth was with Tom Gallagher, and he says, I'm busy till spring. You know, ask me again. And I wrote back, I'm not going to chase you. If you've got something you would like to talk about here, let me know. I'd be happy to have you on the show. And like I have had Dave Sumner and Kay Craigie and many directors, and in the meantime, I'll go talk to other people and let me know. I don't like to, you know, pull. I don't. First of all, I don't have the audience or the clout to be.
But you know, it is kind of interesting though, because there has seemed to have been, in maybe the last year or so, there has been kind of a change. Because, like you said, Kay was, you know, I didn't necessarily agree with Kay all the time, but she was out there. She did get out, you know, Dave the same way and stuff. What I've really been seeing kind of is more of a shutdown barrier kind of thing, you know.
Yeah. Well, if I believed in conspiracies, and I'm not sure I believe one in this case, it's that the word is circulated among the top folks at the ARRL. So when Gary calls you, tell him you're busy, because it's not going to be good for you. And that's not the way that any of these conversations have been. It's been like our conversation, where I will challenge, I will ask, but I won't. You know, I don't have a flamethrower over here.
No.
I got a high-on mic.
That was like my protester. You know, we spent a half an hour going back and forth. I mean, I think dialogue's a good thing. Whether we agree or not, I think it's a good thing. When you, well, one, resort to name calling, which that hasn't occurred yet, or that you just shut down and disengage, it's, you know, you got to wonder how strong is your position. You know, you should be able to, you know, stand a little bit of a challenge.
So maybe the current rest of the world, rest of the country, political climate is infecting people's thinking a little bit too much, and getting into ham radio, and we sort of think that everything has to be polarized to the extreme anymore. That's not the case.
No, even my protester, we found multiple places of common ground. We agreed Greg is generally a nice guy, and that people should have a say in who their representation is. And
the other thing I wanted to mention was that when it comes to anything organizational or political within the league, it's most people don't care. Most hams don't pay much attention. Most hams don't read the minutes.
Well, some say all I'm in it for is the magazine.
Yeah.
And that's sad in a way, because the league does a lot more than just supply a magazine.
Yeah. But then some issue comes up that affects them. And suddenly, the blip comes on their radar that's never been there before because the radar is tuned way down. But suddenly it's right in there, affecting their comfort zone, a mode or an activity or something that they don't like. And then they go nonlinear, they go ballistic, and suddenly anti-league and everything's terrible and this has to be changed. And other people look at them and say, what are you all up about? We don't care about that. We care about this. So,
yeah, everybody has their own little special interests and stuff. There's a number of issues I support. I mean, like I said, some of this legislation, I mean, I've had some questions on it and stuff, but overall, I support hams having antennas. And I think there needs to be a balance in some regard, with homeowners associations. So I'm for these things. Personally, it doesn't affect me. I'm out in the middle of nowhere. I can put up whatever I want. Nobody cares. But for years, I've supported people on that thing. Hey, you need me to sign a petition. You want something. It's not necessarily my issue, but I respect your point. I support that.
I've noticed another conspiracy theory that I'll mention on the Parity Act. It's the guys that are on QRZ that are railing about it, doing all that. Deal with it. You signed a contract. Deal with it. You live with it. I'm happy now to spread this rumor that those guys they've already got their contestation and they don't want any more competition.
Well, some of it too is, I probably shouldn't bring this up, but
between you and me, there's nobody listening. No,
it kind of reminds me of the old code versus no code debate.
Wow. Somebody's taking our picture while you're talking about that. Don't do that.
Yeah, no. I've heard I've been spied on. I was told that the other day. But it's summer. That's why sometimes I tune some of it out. But I do try to look at some of it because if you totally tune everything out, you're going to massively miss relevant items. So I'm not a big, there's a lot of, I've heard conspiracy theories this weekend, and I'm just like, no. I said, yes, I've heard some things, and it does cause me to question some things, but, one of the things, too, is, and I pointed this out to a number of people, I said, you have the incumbent and what had happened to him, and he's put his information out. ARRL hasn't. And you know what they say in the absence of making a statement?
Yeah, well, everybody's going to start assuming, nature abhors a vacuum.
And I really think that ultimately that's really the issue here and where they failed. I mean,
when you do that, when you leave that vacuum, the things that people will guess at are usually worse than the truth.
And it's true. Yeah. So, I mean, you don't have to, you don't have to go off and address every absurd statement out there. But, this was a pretty big thing. A lot of people, some people know this, some people don't. The Southeastern Division is the largest division in the ARRL. There are more members out here. I guess it's because, we have people who retire from up north. Yeah. It is a huge, large...
It's a lot of states, a lot of real estate.
It's a lot of real estate and a lot of population.
And I think that the reason why it is that big is when the call zones were... Southeastern Division isn't set up just by the four call zones.
No, it's not.
Because I'm in North Carolina and I'm in Roanoke. But it's sort of the same thing. The fourth call area is huge. And it is huge because when those things were set up, this part of the country was sleepy and not highly populated.
It wasn't highly populated. And what's happened is due to our society's economics changes, folks have, put away money and they retire and they want to move away from the snow. Well, where do I go? Go to the south.
And it's not just retirement. It is a lot of things have moved people, still working age people. I mean, live in Raleigh, North Carolina, and it's it keeps hitting that best places to live and work list.
A lot of corporations have moved. I mean, I grew up in the Tampa St. Pete area, a lot of companies moved down in the 60s and 70s from up north and set up. And they're still down there doing their thing. So
a lot of it, I think, has to do with air conditioning.
Well, thank God for air conditioning.
Made it livable down here. In fact, this is February, and it's it's Central Florida, so it's not the hardest summer. but it's in the 80s out there. It's a gorgeous day. You know, we're sitting in here.
No, it's, you know what? I got my power bill.
I don't know about you, but I'm freezing. It's cold.
I got my power bill just yesterday in the mail. I checked in on the way home. You know, I remember before I got my AC replaced during the dead of summer, $400 bills. You know, $95. That's it.
Better insulation.
You know, these are things that I'm looking at home improvements down. The big thing was the better AC system.
Yeah.
I bought an older house. It had a 20-year-old system by the time I wound up replacing it. And it's been worth every penny.
Really, I have some friends who've done that too. Oh, same Jeff, AC4ZO, put in a new AC system and, you know, watch his power bill go way down. So to wrap this up, I need to talk to Sean. And
talk to Sean.
And I think I need to talk to Doug. Because what brought this onto my radar was, first of all, seeing your notice on QRZ. Then following the link to the CQ editorial and say, oh my, Rich caught Rich's attention, who wasn't taking a position on should it be Doug, should it be Greg. It was on this seemed to happen in the dark and League is not talking about it. And so I'd like to talk to Doug. But the other thing was, in looking over his timeline and the things that he was talking about, without understanding any of them in detail, they hit some of my hot buttons, which are transparency and openness and, you know, letting the process, a little more sunlight on the process. As I was talking to the guys at the League booth, I understand that you can't have every possible issue be decided by a membership vote.
No.
The League doesn't have membership votes on anything but your section manager and your division director. You don't vote for the vice presidents or the president. You don't vote on individual issues. They'll take surveys. Like, they got a survey that just got started where they want to know about a new possible entry-level license. Don't know if you saw that on their website. It's really new.
Oh, I have to go look. I haven't been on it in a week. Yeah.
There's been a committee at the board that has kicked the idea around. It's not something that they're saying they ought to do. It is something they're saying that we ought to see about, because we need to do something to get more people into ham radio, more young people. And, you know, the discussion is immediately going to flare up. Are we dumbing down ham radio again? There it's the end of ham radio. There we go. I've seen mistakes made in the past, things that seemed like a good idea at the time, but didn't accomplish what they want, like giving novices 220 megahertz. You know, they took 2 meters away from them as just when 2 meters got popular, and they say, well, we'll give the novices 220. Good thing for 220, good thing for novices, total lead balloon, total dud.
Yeah, people get upset when you take away something they had. That's the nature.
Yeah.
I should look at that. I know a number of young guys that, it's amazing, people I know that got their licenses for, years ago, got their licenses because they were flying planes and they wanted those ham radio channels because it was too
crowded. Oh, for the RC, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, and some of them made that leap past that. And I know...
sailors, people put radios in their sailboats and then they become real hams.
These things happen. I a lot of these young engineers that I work with and stuff, there are a lot of these guys are into the drones, you know, and there's, how do they control those? And they got the cameras and stuff. And there are some that have thought, I might want to get my ham license just so I've got access to those extra frequencies, you know.
Yeah, I guess. And, you know, this isn't the 6 meter radio control
this is being able
to move down a little below 2.4 gig into the ham band.
They're in the microwave area. That's what they're looking at. So,
yeah. So I know that as this gets out there, I haven't looked at it on QRZ, but I know that it is going to get lambasted by the same old group. And I don't know what they're asking. They say, well, if we were to do this, what should we do?
At least they're asking. That's a good thing.
Yeah, and I'm not sure I could come up with all the right answers immediately, but people will, because that's the way people are.
Well, people have opinions. Everybody's got an opinion.
Yeah. All right, so thank you very much for coming by.
Thank you for the time.
This issue is, it's not the biggest issue, and it wouldn't rise to the national level other than, because, it's a regional issue.
It's a regional issue that could have national... I mean, because if it happens here, it could happen... Like I said, one of the discussions I said is, they got somebody out. And I mean, not to be a conspiracy theorist, but let's say, you're from Roanoke. you get two guys running, and all of a sudden, days before the other thing go out, they declare one guy ineligible and another guy elected.
Yeah. And
I mean, they can do it again.
I can't really say why. The optics are bad. No matter what is really behind it, it looks bad, smells bad. And so you need to peel back the layers and see why this.
And, you know, if ethics committees can make decisions, ethics and election committees make decisions, they should be willing to stand behind them and present them to the membership.
Yeah. And if it was a case where the board said, we've got a wild card, we've got a rogue here, and, you know, we just don't really want to deal with it, let's find a way to make this go away. Well, of course, that would be terrible. And that would be something they would try very hard to hide. And so that's what it looks like.
It kind of looks like, you know, and the other thing, too, is, God forbid, you know, they may have made a mistake. And you know, and if you did, you know, sometimes it helps to say, sorry, we made a mistake. Maybe
so
we should have handled
it
better.
Here in the last minute of the show, I guess.
Well, like I said, I think transparency would be a good thing, but I definitely think that when you're going to, especially in an election, especially when you're talking about people's representation, if you're going to make a decision, don't do it behind closed doors and communicate it to your members. I think that's important. And I would definitely encourage you probably sit down with Doug. I'm sure Doug could find some time. And I know he's, I know for a fact, for example, in Melbourne, he spent quite a bit of time talking with members about that and conveying his side of the story. It's interesting, and I think he'd be a good interview for you.
Yeah. Well, I'll follow up as soon as I can.
Sounds good.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot.
I appreciate the time. Thank you.
I'll wrap things up here. That is it for this episode of Ham Radio. Tell people once again who you are.
My name is Jim Schilling. I'm KG4JSZ.
Have you ever had an elected or appointed or volunteer position in the league?
Oh, no, not actually. The closest I would say is over in the Tampa St. Pete area, we had a council, Florida Gulf Coast Amateur Radio Council. It was where they sent representatives of the club. This is before the West Central Florida section was formed, back in the 70s, they formed it. And primarily, they're known nowadays for having the Tampa Bay Ham Fest. And I ran that for about 4 years. And matter of fact, very early in my ham career, I got into that. Somehow, you know,
roped you in.
They rope you in very young. I met a guy the other day that's been licensed for about a year. He's about my age and stuff. I said, "Duh, watch what they do to you. They'll rope you in."
Never volunteer.
But it was fun. I enjoyed that. I've been on a board of directors for various clubs from time to time. I know, the only appointment I've had is I was VUCC card checker.
Okay, that's one.
I did that. One club was a special services club. Back before I got my HF privileges, I loved
that. That got people a few extra points if they worked you during the centennial.
This is true. And I liked, in lack of having HF privileges, I love six. I still love 6 meters. My little thing, one of the ways I could help was do that. I do testing with my DX club. I'm an officer in that club, and I do the testing sessions virtually every month. So I do little things as a volunteer. I'm a very low-level ARRL participant.
And now you're a national spokesperson for an issue. On a major ham radio program. Well, a minor ham radio program.
Well, I guess I got some attention.
Yeah, no, you did. Okay, so that will be it. Once again, Arvin, hamradio.tv, blah, blah, blah. I'm Gary Pierce, 73, everybody. Over and out.